Welcome to New Hope Community Church. It is great to have you here. If you are a guest at our church for the very first time today, there are some. This is just a little humorous, guys. This is for the video camera, actually. Tonight is a redo of a Sunday morning service 2 weeks ago. Due to some technical difficulties, the video for that Sunday was lost and didn't get put onto our website. And there were some wanted to hear it, and so rather than preaching to an empty sanctuary, I announced it for a week or two, and so these lovely people showed up tonight to come be here so that we can get it onto our website. And this sermon was the first sermon that I preached after being in the hospital. I had two of my main arteries that were 99 and 90% plugged, and it was a little longer recovery than we thought, and during that time, God was telling me some things that I probably needed to do a better job of in communicating. And so this was a sermon that developed over about 4 weeks during recuperation. And so thank you all for coming out so that I'm not preaching to empty pews. I am confident that the dynamics are probably going to be a bit different than it was 2 weeks ago. But we'll trust the Holy Spirit, all right, for what we need for this evening. And I want to thank our youth pastor for stepping in, and he's going to be leading us in a song that was brand new to most of us in church. A few people had heard it because it's on K-Love. It's getting a lot of airplay right now. But this was a song that meant so much to Shelley, my wife, and she wanted to be here tonight, but she is really sick at the moment, and so she's at home. But during the time that, right after I was released from the hospital to go home and recover for 2 weeks, her dad, who had not been in good health, took a serious turn for the worse. He went into the hospital. Over the next 7 days, she made 5 trips back and forth from Turlock to our house so she could check on me and take care of things there. Her dad ended up going into hospice care, and 27 hours after he was under home hospice care, he passed away. And so all that kind of went on all at the very same time. And this was the song Shelley shared with me the second trip home from Turlock. She said, "This is what has gotten me through the last couple of days. You got to hear this song." And that song then got me through a very difficult night that eventually led to us figuring out that my issues after the surgery was not the stents, but it was medication that I was on. And once I got that figured out, things started getting better ever since then. But this song was a really important song for one of the dark nights of my soul and for a dark period in Shelley's life. And it's called Say Amen. And so Chris was willing to learn it for us and teach it to us tonight. And so you may want to listen the first time around and then jump in. But at any point, if you know it, join in with him. And I'm not sure. Well, some of y'all can sing really good, all right? But you don't want me to sing really loud, all right, under this. So mute me during this part, all right?
See, I know Chris knows the reality of that song personally. And it probably has been driven home for him a bit today.
Today is his baby boy's first birthday, and his baby boy had some complications when he was first born. Why don't you tell him briefly the story?
My wife went into the hospital way before she was on hospital bed rest for 2 weeks, and we had torn my youngest 2 months early, so he lived in the NICU for 2 months. And going back and forth between work and helping out with my other kid and driving back and forth and doing all that stuff. So 2 months he was in there, he was on a ventilator, two different kinds of ventilators, one that just helps you breathe regularly and another one that really kind of shook the chest. So we would come and his chest was doing this. And he was born 3 pounds, 3 ounces. And we just weighed him today and he's 19 pounds and he's a big boy now. So amen. Amen.
Amen. So Chris understands what it means to say amen because he's seen him in the valleys, all right, and had to climb the mountains through some things. And the one prayer request that I will share with you tonight is for Joe and Mary's grandbaby. I shared with you this morning a little bit. In the third service, I got an update because the news had been good this morning. For those of you who don't know anything about it, Joe and Mary Avila, their oldest daughter, Elizabeth, was going to be giving them their first grandchild, due in about 2.5 to 3 weeks from now. And so they zipped down there Friday afternoon, got there about 10 o'clock, and Baby Emma Grace showed up at 12:30 a.m. Saturday morning, and right at 7 pounds, and everybody was quite excited. A couple of hours later, about 2:45 in the morning, we got a text from Mary telling us that there was something not quite normal with baby Grace's breathing, and so they had to take her into ICU. Later that day, we got updates and things were improving. They said she'll be able to go home in 4 days, and everything was going just fine. Got one early this morning from them. All was going good, and so looking forward to taking her home Tuesday. In the third service, then, I got another text saying that there had been some little spells since the last update, similar to the one early Saturday morning. And so the 4 days will start all over again, and then I've got another update late this evening. They're going to do a, let me get this correct, because in case it gets repeated, she will have an ultrasound on her heart tomorrow as a precaution. And the parents are there. Elizabeth and Brian are in the special care unit and feeding Emma at this very moment. And so if you would just be in prayer for them, I know they would appreciate it. They are kind of a long ways from everybody. They would not tell anybody Emma's name for 24 hours because they were naming her. The middle name is after Elizabeth's younger sister, Grace. And Grace lives in Texas, and Grace was flying in. And they didn't want Grace to hear it or see it on Facebook or anything, what her name was, till she got to the hospital and they could tell her personally. And so Grace got there and so found out that her little niece is named after her, Emma Grace. Grace is back on a plane now, back to Texas to be at work tomorrow. So she's a little sad about that under the current circumstances. So just before we preach, let's pause to pray for Emma Grace. Our Father, I find it very interesting that on a day that Chris is celebrating his baby boy's first birthday and been through the fire in his birth, that there is another family in our church who has some very similar circumstances. And so there's understanding that goes on in this fellowship as we pray for Emma Grace. We pray for your best in her life. We know what we think her best is from our perspective. And our best is that everything's okay 4 days from now when she gets to go home. And they look back on these 4 days as just a very tiny little blip in the roadmap of life. But Father, as Chris and Mel, it went 2 months for them. It was a bigger blip. And Father, there have been times that sometimes what we think is best is not what the circumstances turn out to be. And you don't promise us any guarantees of what the outcomes are going to be. What you do promise us is your presence and your power and your comfort and your influence as we go through whatever this world throws at us. And so we pray for Brian and Elizabeth, Emma's mom and dad, and we pray for Joe and Mary. We pray for the other set of grandparents. I'm not sure if they have arrived from the East Coast yet. And we just commit to you all of their needs. And Lord, if there is some spiritual awakening that needs to take place in the lives of some members of this family, and this may be one of those moments, then Father, I pray that any of us would be willing to be available for you to use so that your presence and your desires are readily seen. And so, Lord, we just commit this to you, full of faith that you can do anything you choose to do, and whatever you know is best is where we rest. We say thanks in the name of your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. About 20 years ago now, 21 years ago, I was going through one of the, at that time, it was the lowest moment in my life. It was not long after the merger of our two churches had taken place and we had become one. But within about a year and a half after that, I was going through an extremely low time personally. My financial world had turned upside down. It was a mess. We had bought one house, thought we had the other house sold, moved, and 60 days later, it all fell apart, and it was a mess. And at one of those very low moments, a high school friend, really an acquaintance from high school, one of my best friend's older brother and this gentleman were best of friends through junior high and high school. We had not run into each other after high school until our boys ended up in T-ball together. And our sons became some of the best friends all the way through, still to this very day, they get together and do things. And so his name was Dan Kuntz. And we had reconnected over our boys, and this had gone on for about a year. And at this very low moment of life, and very few people knew about it at that time, certainly not Dan Kuntz. But one day I get a call from Dan Kuntz, and he said, "Hey, you got time for lunch today?" And I said, "Sure." And so he picked a place, and I met him for lunch. You got to remember, this is a guy, until the past year, only on a baseball field, we had reconnected. He knew that I had become a pastor. I knew that he had become a Christian. And that was about all that we knew about each other and our spiritual journeys at that moment. And we had lunch, and I thought he just wanted to talk about our boys' baseball team. And, you know, and as we finished lunch, he said, "Tim, I'm about to do something that I didn't want to do." And I looked at him kind of peculiar, and he said, "I got to tell you, what I'm about to do, I know it's what I'm supposed to do because I've battled it and God has made it very clear." And he said, "I just want you to wait to open this envelope until after I'm gone, but I want you to know I give this to you out of the leadership of God in my life." He said, "I don't know why, I don't know what the circumstances are, I don't know what the situations are, but I know this is what I'm supposed to do." And he slid an envelope across the table. And in that envelope was $2,000. It was enough to take care of two things: the mortgage payment on a house that I had gotten back, and to put a new engine in a car that I just found out that morning I had thrown a rod through the engine. And it was enough to take care of both of those. I was humbled. I was embarrassed. Though he knew nothing about it, he just was following God's leadership. Dan and I have remained friends over these past 20 years now. Our kids have grown up now. And I don't see Dan all that often anymore. But we have common friends and we keep in touch with each other. We send occasional texts. The first Saturday after I got out of the hospital and I was home, Shelly had to make a trip to Turlock. And there's a knock at the front door. And I go answer the front door. Any idea who was standing there? Dan Kuntz was standing there. He said, "Tim, I just heard yesterday what's been going on with you. I wanted to come by, and I'm not going to stay long. You probably don't need a long visit, but I want to come by. I want to pray for you." And he had in his hand, he said, I've got a couple of things that have meant a lot to me at a few tough moments in my life, and I'd like to give them to you. Maybe they'll be helpful to you." And on that day, he gave me two books. One was a book on grace, a very powerful, powerful book on grace. And another one is a book I'm going to read a prayer out of called The Valley of Vision. And I've looked back on those two key encounters between Dan Kuntz and myself, two very critical moments in my life, one a financial crisis, one a physical crisis. And if I had to tell you today what did more for me than the other, I would have to say the two books have become more valuable than money. At the time, the money was big. But as I look back, I've got to tell you, what got me through one of the dark nights of my soul was one of the prayers that was at the beginning. And I really didn't think I would like this book when he gave it to me. It's an ugly cover. The title of the book is The Valley of Vision, a book of Puritan prayers. That did not really excite me a whole lot until I opened it and I began to read it. With that background, let me read to you The Valley of Vision. "Lord, high and holy, meek and lowly, you have brought me to the Valley of Vision, where I live in the depths, but I see in the heights. Hemmed in by the mountains of sin, I behold your glory. Let me learn by paradox that the way down is really the way up. That to be low is to be high. That the broken heart is the healed heart. that the contrite spirit becomes the rejoicing spirit, that the repenting soul is the victorious soul, that to have nothing is to possess everything, that to bear the cross earns me the right to wear the crown, that to give away is to receive, that the valley is the place of vision. Lord, in the daytime, stars can be seen from the deepest wells, and the deeper the well, the brighter the stars. Let me find your light in my darkness, your life in my death, your joy in my sorrow, your grace in my sin. Let me find your riches in my poverty, and your glory in my valley. Amen. Can you say amen? Amen. I'll be honest, probably making a bigger thing out of it than it really was, but a Wednesday night in a hospital and a Tuesday night in my home, I really wasn't sure I would live to see the morning. Shelley sang and prayed and read scripture and got her phone out and did YouTube worship songs with me. We listened to Say Amen probably a dozen times during that night. And then we prayed together this prayer. It was from the hospital bed on that Wednesday night. And I was alone that night. I had sent Shelley home the night before. She'd been up with me all night the night before. And so I sent her home to get some rest that night. I said, I'm doing okay. I woke up about midnight, and that's when it got dark. And I prayed, and I found my Bible on my phone because I hadn't brought mine from the office. And so I read scripture. And about 3 a.m., I knew it was 6 a.m. where my friend Jack Williams lived. Jack Williams has been a mentor of mine for 40 years. He was one of my professors in Bible college, and he has been the dearest friend. Some of you have met Jack. He preached Mom's funeral service. He preached in this pulpit. A little short guy, all right, but powerful in the Word. And I knew Jack would understand far more than I did where I was coming from that night, because just 3 years ago, 2 days after Christmas, Jack had a massive stroke. We prayed for him here at our church. He lost all use of his left side. They weren't sure he was going to live. I was prepared to fly back at any moment. And after several days, and he stabilized some, he said, Tim, come in a few months when we can enjoy some time together. And Shell and I went a couple of months later, and we spent a couple of days with Jack. And so I knew he would understand the dark night of the soul, the valley of vision. And I said, Jack, I'm struggling. In short order, I got an answer back from Jack. He said, Tim, let me give you a verse God gave to me. When I couldn't talk, when I couldn't respond to other people, God gave me a verse. He said, it's John 13:7. And ever the teacher, he didn't type out the verse for me. I had to open my Bible. And at first I was a bit annoyed because, you see, in the culture I was raised in, I thought I knew John chapter 13 backwards and forwards. I grew up in a denomination. It was called Free Will Baptist. And the Free Will Baptist denomination is one of only a half a dozen out of hundreds of denominations in this country that observe a third ordinance. Most denominations observe two ordinances, and that is baptism and communion. Okay, that's pretty standard. Free Will Baptists, along with a few others, Nazarenes, Missionary Baptists, there's some more, they're not coming to me, but they observe a third one, and it's called feet washing. And John chapter 13 is where you find it. And so growing up, I thought I knew John chapter 13 backwards and forwards. And by the way, just a side note, I still do feet washing on occasions. We don't do them church-wide as I used to every year growing up. We do them. We've done them some here at New Hope. Some people say, ooh, yeah, that was just figuratively. No, Jesus really did wash the disciples' feet, okay? And just a thought, if you get to the middle of that, after the story is told, Jesus says to his disciples, you ought to do this to one another. Now I'm going to quote my dad for a moment. I grew up hearing this sermon every year at feet washing time. Ought, what does that mean? You ought, you should, you shall, you are duty bound. When you tell your kids they ought to do something, what did you mean? They ought to do it. Yeah, so it's there. But I'm thinking, God, what does John 13:7 say? So I opened my Bible on my phone, and I read it. Jesus answered and said unto him, and the him here is Simon Peter. You see, Jesus had washed some of the other disciples' feet already. And he gets to Peter, and Peter says, Lord, are you going to wash my feet? And you have to understand, it doesn't come clearly in the text. You have to understand a little bit of the Greek here. This was not a question of, Lord, are you going to wash my feet too? This was a question statement of, Lord, you're not going to wash my feet, are you? And this is when Jesus replies to Peter, what I do now, you don't understand, but you will know later. I read that about 3:30 in the morning, and I thought, what in the heck does that mean? And I grabbed onto the first part that I could understand. I don't understand it right now. I don't understand it right now. Somewhere down the road, okay, maybe God will explain. Maybe when I get to heaven, I'll understand it. It was about 3 hours later when the sun started to come up, and I went back and I read it again. All of a sudden, my heart got lighter. As the day got brighter with the sun, my heart got lighter with the sun. Because what I understood, that Jack understood, and he was trying to let me know is, oh God, I've got a later. This isn't it. You're not finished with me yet. I don't understand this now. This is going to teach me something. And I've got a later to express it and experience it. Okay. And that became my hope over the next several days. During my dark nights of the soul, I realized there were some things that I needed to share with the staff and our church family at New Hope. And that's where the rest of this comes from today. First thing I wanted to share with everybody is New Hope is not a perfect church. Is that startling to you? I mean, probably not. New Hope is not a mega church. Not tonight. Okay? But here's what I do want you to know. New Hope is a very healthy church. On almost every set, not a perfect church, but on almost every area that you look at, it is a very healthy church. How do I know that? Let me just share some statistics with you. Did you know the average church in America is 75? This morning, as churches gathered all across America, the average size of church is 75. And we should not look down our nose at that. Okay? Whether the church has 20 in it or whether the church has 2,000 in it, those are God's people being available to God's purpose, wanting to their spot in their world to be the light that God can shine through. The average is 75. This morning, I think we had 539. The average budget of a church, a congregation in this country is $210,000. At the end of this year, we will probably report to you that tithes and offerings and gifts through New Hope will probably exceed $850,000. And I remember when we merged 23 years ago, our annual budget was $110,000. Hey. On average, the average congregation in America gives away 3% to missions and outside causes. And we are going to come very, very close to 25% this year. 25%. Guys, I got to tell you, that thrills my heart. That thrills my heart. My desire as a pastor, the things that have governed my decisions and ministry have been threefold. And I didn't understand this until a month ago. Well, if you had asked me, Tim, how do you make decisions? What's been the influence in your life that made decisions? I would share in the Scripture. And that still is true. But I didn't realize till laying there in bed, I was thinking and rethinking about what it means to be in ministry and to be a pastor and to be part of a fellowship of God in this world. What is it that has kind of directed my course? And it's probably going to be different for everyone, but this is the way God has imprinted His life into my spirit. And I discovered there were three things that have influenced my life, particularly as a pastor. Number one, for reasons I do not understand, and it started very early in my life, maybe it was because of the heritage that I have, but I have always wanted to honor the past. I have always wanted to honor the legacy that I was given. The second thing that has influenced my decisions is I've always wanted to do what we possibly could to strengthen the present. I wanted to continue to build and fortify the legacy that was entrusted to me by good men and women in my past. And number three, I have always wanted to work together with the past and where I am at the present so that together we could prepare the church for the future, for the next generation. I wanted to leave a legacy that our children can build upon. So I want to look at each of those a little bit more in depth. Number one, let's honor the past, the legacy that I was given. I was blessed. As I met with Roy after church today, and we had lunch, and I heard his story of an abusive father who beat him, put him in a hospital for 6 months. What he didn't tell you is the rest of the story. His dad is now a Christian, and the church that Roy leads and the camps that Roy leads meets on his dad's ranch property. Okay? Roy's entire family have come to know Christ, and most of them simply because they were willing to volunteer at the camps, and hearing the story of the kids led them to Christ. And I sat across the table at lunch today, and I said, Roy, I marvel at your story. I said, because that is as foreign to me as if I were to speak Russian today. I said, because I did not grow up in that kind of home. I had a mom and dad who loved me. More importantly, I had a mom and dad who had a passion for God. Not only did I have a mom and dad who had a passion for God, I had grandparents on both sides who had passions for God. And I said, I grew up knowing from the age of 10 on I was going to be a preacher. I've been preaching since 15. And I said, I marvel how you survived your past. And so I've wanted to honor the past that I was given. My reasons for staying at the Bible College here in Fresno when I was in my late teens and my early 20s, I had an opportunity to go to Oklahoma. In fact, I wanted to go to the college in Oklahoma because it was bigger. There were more opportunities. And my mother and one of my mother's best friends drove all night long to get me to Oklahoma so I could go to hospitality days. And at the end of that, they recruited me, and I signed saying I'm coming in the fall. And on the way home, as we crossed the Colorado River coming into California, it was like God threw a billboard sign up in front of me that says, you were birthed here, you have been raised here, your father and your grandfather have spent their life building churches in this state. Do you think you need to go to Oklahoma to get more opportunities? Who gives you opportunity, Oklahoma or me? I popped up and said to my mom and Nettie Lou Jernigan, I said, thanks for the trip, but I'm staying in California because this is where God planted me, and I did not want to turn my back on a legacy that had been given. My reasons for staying at Memorial Church, the church that merged with this one 23 years ago, the church had been a strong church when my sister and I grew up. It's a church that Dad started for the next generation and had been strong. And when I got finished with Bible College, I was working at the Bible House. I had the best of both worlds, guys, I got to tell you. At that time of my life, I had the best of both worlds. I was managing Fresno Bible House, so I had my foot in the business world, but still doing ministry every single day there. And I got to preach on Sundays, and I didn't have to be a pastor, okay? Dad was a pastor. Dad didn't like preaching. I love preaching. I didn't really care a whole lot about the pastoring part. God had to change me in that area. And so I had the best of both worlds. But as churches often experience, sometime in the course of their history, division occurred, and it came from one of those closest to my dad, one of his dearest friends, and led a bit of a coup, and the church had been crippled. And Dad was tired and prepared to retire, and I didn't want Dad's ministry that had been so good for so long to end with a bad taste. And I stayed put when I had opportunities to go elsewhere. And then when we merged these two churches together, I had known Bob Radke, the founder of the original New Hope. I had known him from my Bible House days. I remember when he decided on the name for this church. And so as we merged those two, I didn't want either one of them to be completely wiped out, because these were two men who had a great love for God from a different generation, and they wanted to carry it on to the next. And so we've done our best to honor them. I didn't make some moves because I believe God wired me with a sense of Gilgal. And Gilgal out of the Old Testament was the altar that was built by the children of Israel when they crossed the river of Jordan into the Promised Land. And God told Joshua to tell the people, every time you walk by this altar, tell your children and your grandchildren how God kept His promises and provided for your needs in their past. And I think all of us need a sense of Gilgal that connects us to our past. I also want to be firmly rooted in the present living foundation of a cross and an empty tomb, and my hope is focused on a returning King. To those of you who are... Okay, this is going to be awkward. Okay, Chris, to those of you who are younger and under 40... On that Sunday we did this. This is for the tape. We had a lot. I had them stand up, okay? It was good. It was good. To those of you under 40, here's my challenge to you. Build relationships with those of us who are older. 1 Peter 5:5 says something quite fascinating. Let me turn there. 1 Peter 5:5. It says, likewise, you who are younger, submit yourselves to the elders. Yet all of you be subject one to another, be clothed in humility, for God resists the proud, but He gives grace to the humble. And so to those of you who are younger, humbly build bridges to those of us who are older. Hopefully we have gained some wisdom from our foolish youthfulness, and our likes and our dislikes are not because we are old. Our likes and our dislikes are what we learned when we were your age. What you are shaping now is your future. Your likes and dislikes are based upon where you are right now. And so please know, our tastes in music, our tastes in clothes is not because we're old. It's because it's what we liked when we were young. Build bridges, not walls. Let's go on to the second thing that shaped the course of my life. I wanted to honor the past, but number two, I wanted to strengthen the present. I want to continue to build and fortify this legacy that has been given. But how do we do that? First and foremost, if we're going to strengthen the present, it starts by us being a church that meets the needs of other people. And I hope that has been the groundwork for everything that we've done in ministry out of New Hope. And just to highlight a few of those things, how about Celebrate Recovery? The reason that we have a Celebrate Recovery out of New Hope Church is because we want to meet needs. The vision of Celebrate Recovery is if you have hurts, habits, or hang-ups. All three of those sound like needs to me, doesn't it? And it sounds like probably every one of us in here could use Celebrate Recovery, because all of us have some hurts, all of us have some habits, all of us have some hang-ups that probably need to be addressed. And so we started Celebrate Recovery out of the desire to meet needs of others. Grief Share got started at New Hope because two women who normally sit in the second service right back there, third row in front of the sound booth, because Judy and Nan, just months apart, unexpectedly lost their husbands. And as they, being mature Christians, were looking for a way to not let this defeat them and destroy them, they found a ministry called Grief Share. And they researched it, and they came as a team, and they said, Pastor, we think this would be good for us to do at New Hope Church. And they were right. And Grief Share has been going on for over 15 or 16 years. We tried to do some figures here a while back, and probably over 250 men and women have been through Grief Share here at New Hope. What did it do? It meets a need. Prison Fellowship has walked side by side with us in ministry. What for what purpose? To meet the needs not only of the incarcerated, but also the needs of their children and their spouses on the outside, and to help them once they've been released from their incarceration. We have a ministry that got started by the Actis family, who now serve in Africa, and their first step into missions was addressing the needs of. And then we have missions that take us literally around the world. Meet needs. That's how you strengthen the present. Number two, we care for the people that God provides us opportunities. Every Sunday morning, there's about 60 to 100 children during two services that come through our doors of our Jam Center over there. Have the opportunity through story form to teach them the message of the gospel, and it takes volunteers to do that. Over in that building there, every single week, there are between 40 and 70 high school kids who go through the walls of those of that building right over there, and they need volunteers to come alongside of them and minister to them. And it's why we have Chris on staff right now for that purpose. We have ministries from families to seniors that are going on, families caring for families, and we do it in so many other ways, weddings and funerals and hospital visits. Don't belong to a church for what the church can do for you, but become part of God's family for how together we can strengthen the church and we advance His kingdom in our part of the world. Number three, we strengthen the present by working hard and being selfless. I have never had a goal to pastor a mega church. It's always been my desire to pastor a meaningful church. It's up to God how big the church is going to be. If you remember one of the parables that Jesus told about planting and harvesting. And at harvest time, He said, God, some fields will return 30-fold, and some 60-fold, and some 100-fold. And what makes the difference? It's not the seed in Mark chapter 4. Mark 4 tells us the size of the harvest is up to God, not up to us. Our contribution is to be good soil. Good soil. 30, 60, 100, all produced out of good soil. Not much is produced out of bad soil. To those of us who are older, you're probably under 40. Are you under 40? Yeah. God bless you. So is Roy, by the way. If anybody wanted to know how old Roy was today, we called him because there was a bet outside of how old Roy was. He is 51. To those of us who are older, we're over 40. That's everybody in the room except for Chris right now. So to the rest of us, my challenge to you is build understanding relationships with young people. Get out of your comfort zone. 1 Timothy 4:12 says, don't despise others because they're young. Timothy in the Bible was a young pastor. Don't despise him. Titus chapter 2, verse 6, and I want to read that one. Titus chapter 2, verse 6 gives us another direction. He says, Young men, likewise, be of sober mind. And so you and I need to work together with young men and young women in our church. It challenges us not to look down on those, but to encourage them. Why? That's our future. You've been hearing me say for about 18 months, I've got about 8 to 10 years here. I found out last month it might not be that long. Okay? Might not be. There's no guarantee. There is no guarantee. So we need to be prepared today for changes that may come in our future. The work for the kingdom of God is going to be entrusted to them, and why not share it with them in the meantime? Instead of them having to go out and start something brand new or find something brand new because the old has become a burden, let's be sensitive to the changing styles so that the substance and the source of truth is not lost. And last of all in this area, the changes that we have made, and this has been a huge year of change at New Hope. It is not because New Hope is broken, but it's because together, as we honor the past and we strengthen the present, we want together to prepare for the future. And that's the last thing we'll talk about. I want to leave a legacy for the next generation to build on. And how do we do that? Number one, we maintain biblical foundations. This is imperative. Our styles may change, our methodology may change, but we must maintain the biblical foundation. And what is that number one part of that foundation, the number one ingredient of that foundation? Peter said it well as he responded to a question that Jesus asked him when Jesus said, "Peter, who do you say that I am?" And Peter responded to Jesus that day and he said, "Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God." And I love the tongue-in-cheek response that Jesus gave to Peter. In essence, in modern English, what Jesus said to Peter was, "Peter, you're not smart enough to figure that out on your own." The way it says it in the King James is this, "Peter, flesh and blood has not revealed this to you. You could have only figured this out by the Spirit of God." It's absolutely right. We do not build a church on anything but the person of Jesus Christ. We must maintain those biblical foundations. Number two, and the order is important, biblical foundations first. Number two, we need to enhance our strengths. Continue to develop the gifts and the strengths that God has given us. Those are described in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 16 and 17. But God has given to the church and to us as members of the church various and different and unique gifts. Chris can play instruments. Guitar is not his primary instrument, but it's hard to lead music playing a tuba. Thank you very much. Hard to lead music playing a tuba. He's a great instrumentalist. He can sing. He can carry a tune. He's got rhythm. Okay? I can't do that. That is not my gift. Quite frankly, I have one gift. I shoot my mouth off. It's what God has given me. And we need to enhance that, develop whatever gifts we have and use them together. And then, as we maintain our biblical foundations, as we enhance our strengths, number three, we must expand our influence and our reach. Holy Spirit-driven ministry is usually at the intersection of need and opportunity. This doesn't come just out of a great brainstorm, just because we're really creative. No, I think Holy Spirit-driven ministry is when, number one, there is a need, and we see that need as an opportunity to meet it. Grief Share, Celebrate Recovery, two key examples of how there was a need, and there was an opportunity, and we met those. And so as we are strengthening our gifts, we then are able to expand our influence. And this is accomplished by, one, being students of the Word. There is nothing a church can do that replaces our engagement with the Word of God. Again, over lunch today, I was talking to Roy. I said, "Roy, tell me about your church." Because remember, if you were here this morning, he told you his church was primarily a church that got started to be a place of refuge and help and learning and maturity for inmates coming out of prison, for the Angel Tree kids who were coming to know Christ in the camps because their fathers were or mothers were incarcerated. They had a place to come. And he said, "Tim," he said, "we're kind of a mobile church. We meet in different places. Okay? Our primary place of meeting is at my dad's ranch." Okay? And he said, "When we get everybody there, we have a short service. We do some worship. We have a short sermon." And he said, "A lot of the folks who are coming hungry. They're coming from the poor parts. They don't have a lot. Our inmates, who are now free, donate their time. The church provides the food, and they barbecue, and they cook. And the folks who come to church, they get a plate full of food and they go sit at a table." And he said, "But they can go sit at any table they want to, but strategically placed at every table on the property is a mature ex-inmate and a partner. And so at that table, when everybody's finished eating, they say, 'Now, we're going to open our Bibles together. Your stomach has been filled. Now we want to feed your soul.'" And he said, "They take an hour and they do one chapter out of the Bible." And he said, "It won't work a lot of places." But he said, "That works for us." And what that told me is we must be students of the Word. Number two, we must be submissive in prayer. As the Word penetrates our heart and our mind, we then must humbly come before God to listen to what He has to say to us and then respond to this conversation. Listen to this great prayer that I found in that Puritan book of prayers that I wasn't going to like. "Lord, Let angels sing for sinners who are repenting, for prodigals who are returning, for backsliders who are reclaimed, for Satan captives who've been released, for blind eyes that have been opened, for broken hearts that have been bound up, for the despondent who are now cheered, the self-righteous who have been stripped, for the ignorant who are now enlightened, and for the saints who are being built up in their holy faith. God, I ask great things because you are a great God. Number three, we should also be laser focused in our areas of ministry. If you're part of a fellowship, you need to have an area of ministry. The teddies of the world are hard to come by. Teddy works for Barry and Barry's business. I married Teddy and Christy a dozen years ago. They sat very quietly on the fourth pew, that side aisle, for about 5 years. I asked them to serve on one committee because they were in their 30s, and I wanted a couple in their 30s on a committee, and they said yes. And we unleashed a monster. All it took was to ask. I said, how many times did a clipboard pass by you asking you to sign up for something and you never? He said, nobody ever. I said, a dozen times at least, if not 100 times, a clipboard came by you asking for volunteers. You know, he said, we didn't know. We thought we had to be asked first. And now Teddy is on the elder board. He volunteers for the high school group. He helps to run. He's half the leadership of our small groups. And if there's any other thing that you ask him to do, he does it. All right? And if there's something you need, it's probably in the trunk of his car. All right? That guy has more stuff in the back of his car. I hope it's all legal. But most of us, most of us, God has an area of ministry. Okay? You need one. God's given you a gift. If you're part of his family, it needs to be used. Be laser focused. I was taught a principle many, many years ago. Narrow your focus, increase your force. Narrow your focus, increase your force. And I said, explain that to me. And they said, think of a fire hose. That's the way a fire hose works. It's this big at the fire hydrant. By the time it gets to the end of the hose, they can tighten that down depending on the stream that they want. And the more they tighten it down, the more powerful the force is. God wants to do that in our lives in ministry. Next, be sensitive to the needs in our care. Who's close to you that has a need? It's your opportunity to meet it. Be aware of the times in which we live in. We can't connect to the next generation with last generation methodology. We connect the truth, but we can't always do it the same way. When I was in elementary school, these didn't even exist. Okay? Laptops. I used to preach off of blank spots in my Bible is where I wrote my notes when I first started preaching. Then I moved to a notebook. I eventually got to typing. Now I preach from an iPad. Times are different. And the way we connect to people is going to be different. And we've got to figure that out. Knowing ministry is messy. It is inconvenient. It is unpredictable. This is a marathon, folks. This is not a sprint. We're in this for the rest of our lives. Churches don't need marketing makeovers. What we need are people-loving, God-honoring, passion-driven disciples of Christ who desire their gifts for an eternal purpose with a pursuit of excellence. Did you get that? Let me say that one again, one more time. What the church needs is not a marketing makeover, but we need people-loving, God-honoring, passion-driven disciples of Christ who desire to use their gifts for an eternal purpose with the pursuit of excellence. Don't settle for, hey, this is the church, that's good enough. No, he deserves our best. Family bringing relatives and friend bringing friends is the best way to grow a church. Two things were clear about the most important desires in my life. As I laid in a bed going through the dark night of my soul, two things were clear. I had two very important desires. The two things I thought about when I wasn't sure I would see the light of a new day. I was, number one, concerned about my family. Have I done everything possible in my ability and with my attitude and with my efforts to ensure spiritual wholeness and holiness in the life of my son Brandt and my son Chad and his wife Katie and our daughter Ashley? Have I done everything possible? Is there anything I need yet to say? And my only other desire was New Hope Church. Have I, as pastor, done everything possible within my ability, my attitudes, and my efforts to ensure that those God have entrusted here to us have the opportunity to live in spiritual wholeness and holiness? And that was the reason for this message. Why? What would I want New Hope to remember when I'm dead and gone? What would I want them to remember that I believed and I taught with passion? I would want them to know to love Christ first and most, number one. Number two, love others and yourself. I think those are rather biblical, don't you? I think Jesus said, those two things you can hang the rest of the law of the prophets on. Love the Lord your God and love your neighbor as yourself. Number three, grow in your love and your knowledge of this book. I want New Hope people to be people of the Word of God. Number four, discover grace. Discover grace, enjoy grace, be amazed by grace, share grace, live a grace-fueled life. Don't be looking for the bad stuff everybody's doing. Look how you can encourage. I want a church where grace is on tap. You'd have to go to a bar to know what I mean by that, right? I want church, though, to be a place where grace is on tap. It's fresh. It's vibrant. It's real. If you were here several years ago, 12, 14 years ago, I preached an Easter Sunday morning service, most of the most unusual Easter Sunday morning service I ever preached. The title of it was, I Love This Church. And the basis came from a country western song. I love this bar. That's exactly right. I was listening to that coming home, driving home with my son from a baseball tournament. I had a country station on. That's the first time I heard Toby Keith's song, I Love This Bar. And my wife loves Toby Keith, okay? Bob Thomas, who's going to be here next month, actually from Oklahoma, he lives about 3 miles from Toby Keith's place. And when we were there the last time, Shelley wanted to see it, so we drove by. We drove by so many times, I was worried they were going to call the cops and arrest us, all right, for peeping Toms. But you see, what touched me about that song is how come somebody didn't write that same song and say, church? Because everything that Toby Keith said in that song about why people loved their bar ought to be true about the church, not about a bar. It ought to be true about us. We need grace on tap, a church that dispenses grace and not religion. We need to discover prayer as a running conversation. We need to listen more and talk less. We need to be selfless. Give of yourself and of your resources hilariously. Just as the church will give away 25%, pretty close to it this year, of what it comes in. Shelley and I are trying very, very hard to get to 20% in our own personal lives. And we're getting close. We're getting close. A statistic says less than 2.5% of the people who attend church every Sunday tithe or give consistently. 2.5%. It's sad. We need to be givers. We need to discover our place in the kingdom of God. We need to compassionately care for the least, for the poor, for the homeless, for the imprisoned, for those in far-flung countries. We need to share our life of faith with others and, when necessary, use words. Here's a good test of how well we love. Are other people glad to spend time with us? Do other folks like to hang out with us? Somehow Jesus managed to attract the kind of people that were frowned upon by most religious types. And yet those renegades clearly liked being with Jesus. Think of the prostitute who crashed a dinner party and anointed him with expensive perfume. Think of Zacchaeus, a tax collector, scorned believers as a Roman collaborator. Rather than judging them, Jesus extended grace to them. He honored them. And in the process, he brought to the surface a thirst that only his truth could satisfy. And last of all the above, those other nine things I've just talked about are only possible when you and I rest and abide in the full sufficiency of Jesus Christ, the one who says he is our strength. When you're worried about dying, we're probably fearful about living. I'll close with this. A young man was getting ready to graduate from college. For a lot of months, he had admired a beautiful sports car in the dealer's showroom. Knowing that his father could easily afford this vehicle, he told his dad, "Pop, that's all I want for graduation." Just that probably $40,000 sports car. "It's all I want, Pop, nothing else, don't worry about it." As graduation day approached, the young man awaited signs that his father had purchased the car. Finally, on the morning of his graduation, his father called him into his private study at the home. His father told him how proud he was to have such a fine son, and he told him how much he really loved him. He handed his son a beautifully wrapped box. A little disappointed, but somewhat curious, the young man opened the box, and inside the box, he found a lovely leather-bound Bible. It had the young man's name engraved on the front in gold. Angrily, the son raised his voice at his father and he said, "With all the money that you have, you gave me a Bible?" And he tossed it down on his father's desk and he stormed out of the house. He never returned to his father's house. Years passed. The young man became very successful in business all on his own. He had a beautiful home. He had a wonderful family. It dawned on him that his father was getting quite elderly. He began to think, maybe I ought to go to him. He had not seen him since that graduation day. But before the son, who had now become thoughtful, could make arrangements to go see his father, he received a telegram telling him that his dad had died and that he had willed all of his possessions to his only son, and he needed to come home immediately and take care of things. When the son arrived at the father's house, sudden sadness and regret filled his heart. He began to search through his father's important papers. And sitting at that desk, he looked over at the corner of the desk where years before he had thrown that Bible. And he saw it still sitting in the box on the corner of his father's desk. He reached for the Bible and he began to open it. And he began to turn the pages. And his father had carefully underlined a verse, Matthew chapter 7, verse 11. And it said, "And if you, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more shall your heavenly Father, which is in heaven, give to those who seek him?" And as he read those words, a car key dropped from the back of the Bible. It had a tag on it with the dealer's name, the same dealer that had the sports car he had desired. And on the tag was the date of his graduation and these three words, "Paid in full." I wonder how many times you and I have been like that son. We have missed God's blessings because they're not packaged in the way that we think they ought to be packaged. I promise you this. If you unwrap this package, throughout your life, you will be blessed beyond you can imagine. That is what I hope none of us ever forget. And it's why I believe we should honor the past, strengthen the present, and prepare for the future so generation after generation can build their lives on the reality of the Word of God. If you believe that, could you say amen? Amen. Amen. Let's pray. Our Father, as the words of that song say, sometimes through the darkness, it's hard to see. And so, Father, in those moments, we must trust in you and follow wherever it is that you lead us. Because, Father, the Bible tells us, greater is he who is in us than the one who is in the world. So we must remember, as your children, the battles we face in this life are God's, and we must trust you through them all. Father, thank you. Thank you today that I understand what my friend and my mentor, Jack Williams, meant a little bit better today than I did a month ago when he gave me a scripture verse that says, "You may not understand now what I'm doing, but later you will." And Father, I am blessed that today is later. Thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. God bless you. That was probably longer than the Sunday morning regular service, okay? But I took liberties.